Hey, 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 it's LabPadre. Welcome back, and thanks for tuning in to episode 27 of our SpaceX and Starbase weekly updates. We've got the goods for you today, so let's dig in. Late Friday morning, crews removed one of Ship 24's vacuum Raptors and took it back to the build site. Sunday night, SpaceX launched its Starlink 4-20 mission, along with a single rideshare satellite from Space Launch Complex 40. Tuesday, SpaceX support ship Bob towed a short fall of Gravitas out to sea for the next launch. Back at Starbase, two horizontal cryogenic storage tanks were relocated from Sanchez to the new SpaceX site, formerly known as Massey's Gun Range. Early Wednesday morning, the colored lights which SpaceX uses to alert workers as to the status of the launch tower were tested. Back in Florida, Falcon 9 booster B1069 was moved to the horizontal transporter for its trip to SpaceX's refurbishment facilities. Nearby, crews had a Dragon capsule in the water performing recovery drills. Currently, Crew 4 is expected to return next month following the Crew 5 launch. A few hours later, Doug returned to port carrying both of the fairing halves from Sunday's Falcon 9 launch. That night, back at Starbase, the Raptor maintenance platform was lowered from the launch mount and placed on its stand. A few hours later, a flex pipe was lifted and attached to the new water piping on the bottom of the launch mount. Later, the other end was lifted and temporarily secured to the underside of the mount. Early Thursday morning, SpaceX's LR-11000 crane was relocated from the orbital launch pad to the former landing pad near B7.1. Later that morning, as SpaceX prepared for testing, the chopsticks were raised partway up the tower. A few hours later, Booster 7 performed another spin prime test. Unlike other recent tests, this was not just a few Raptors that spun up, but rather most, if not all, 33 engines appeared to spin up. Later, Ship 24 stepped into the spotlight with another static fire. This was the first six-engine static fire with Raptor 2s seen at Starbase. Unfortunately, as a result of the ship's static fire, a brush fire ignited near the launch site. Over the next several hours, the fire continued to burn and spread westward towards the build site as firefighting crews could not move past the roadblock until the ship and booster were both safed. Eventually, crews were able to fight the fire, performing controlled burns to stop the fire. At Port Canaveral, Tug Kurt J. Crosby returned towing Just Read the Instructions and B1057 into port following Sunday's launch. Shortly after, the booster was moved to the dock, freeing the drone ship for its next mission. Our photographer Greg Scott took to the skies once again this week, allowing us to bring you another Cape Canaveral flyover update. Starting off at the Launch Complex 39B, NASA's SLS rocket still sits on the pad. Following two launch scrubs last week, NASA is working to correct the issues and evaluate their path forward. Currently, it looks like NASA is aiming for another Artemis 1 launch attempt as soon as September 23rd, following a cryo test on the 17th to verify the repair to the hydrogen quick disconnect. They will also need a waiver from the U.S. Space Force Eastern Range to allow for the additional drain on the flight termination system batteries due to the extended stay at the pad. Over at SpaceX's Launch Complex 39A, work continues at a brisk pace. A new gray tank has been built at the northeast corner of the launch site that looks very similar to the white tank that was built at Roberts Road several months ago. The auxiliary hook on the newly reconfigured Buckner LR-11350 crane can be seen in action inside the launch tower while the eighth module waits nearby to be lifted into place. Behind the crane, we can see that crews have been doing additional ground clearing for future development. Work has also continued on the new double-walled tank being built between Starship Tower and the Falcon 9 Tower. It appears that the final ring segments have been stacked and that nearby the top dome for the inner tank is awaiting installation while the top dome for the outer tank is being constructed. Next, let's move to the southwest to the SpaceX facilities at Roberts Road. SpaceX has been hard at work on both sides of this facility in recent months. The expansion of Hangar X appears to now be complete. The focal point of this addition seems to be the large north-facing window wall that should allow for launch viewing. Development continues on the west side of the facility, which has become the Starship production site. At the tower prefabrication area, the bases for the five tower section jigs have been placed back onto the concrete bases, possibly in preparation for additional tower construction in the near future. While no new corner columns have yet been spotted, additional steel is accumulating near the jigs. Crews are busy trying to finish preparing the ninth and final module of the 39A launch tower from rollout. This module has already been moved off its concrete bases and placed on some cribbing, likely to allow additional clearance for the angled steel beams that will attach to Module 8. Already installed on this top module is the crown block for the chopsticks lifting cable, as well as the four pulleys that will translate the cable from the crown block to the back two sides of the tower to drop to the drawworks winch and the dead anchor. To the west of the tower assembly area, crews continue work on preparing the chopsticks and carriage for installation, including the addition of a rack of hydraulic accumulators on the chopsticks. New groundwork can be seen in the northwest corner of the site, where there was a small pond last flyover, which has since been filled and brought up to grade. Just to the south of this area, work continues on the Roberts Road Star Factory. The roof is nearly complete of the first segment of the building, and cladding has been attached to the end wall. Steel continues to go up in the middle section of the building, and some of the steel has already been painted white as well. So far, no supplemental beams for bridge cranes are visible in this part of the building. The concrete slab work continues to work towards the southern edge of the building as underground mechanical work and column foundations are still being worked on. And in the final corner of the Starship side of the facility, it appears that steel work for the mega bay is ready to begin. The new LR-11000 has been assembled and is staged outside what will be the building's doorway, while a second crane is staged in the center of the foundation. We can also see a square concrete pad that should be used to prefabricate the corners of the sections of the building, which will be lifted into place by the LR-11000. Shifting over to Blue Origin's Cape Canaveral production facilities, we can see that construction continues here as well. Behind the warehouse building, groundwork is progressing in preparation for new construction in that location. Steelwork continues on the addition of the southern end of the warehouse building. On the ground, we can see workers prefabricating a roof section for later installation. Meanwhile, the red crane is hooked onto the next steel column to be installed. At the north end of the facility, normal operations continue. Also, nearby construction on the new Glen second stage cleaning and testing building is progressing. The roof and main exterior walls appear to be complete, and cladding has been added to the new sliding door. Moving roughly 8 miles to the southeast, we find Blue Origin's LC-36. This location is the future launch site for the New Glenn rocket. While the launch site currently sits quiet, New Glenn's first orbital test flight could come as soon as next year. Just to the south of Blue Origin's launch facilities is Space Launch Complex 46. Earlier this year, the site hosted two launches of Astra's now-retired Rocket 3, both of which unfortunately failed to make it to orbit, prompting Astra to move on to their Rocket 4. A few miles up the coast is Launch Complex 16. This facility is currently home to Relativity Space's first orbital-class Terran 1 rocket. In recent weeks, this 3D-printed rocket has been undergoing testing, including a 20-second static fire of its 9 Aeon engines, in preparation for its first orbital flight test, which could come as soon as this month. We are also lucky enough to catch ULA's rocket ship docked at Port Canaveral this week. This ship is used by ULA to transport boosters, second stages, and payload fairings from their production facility in Decatur, Alabama, to the launch facilities at Cape Canaveral. Here you can see a Delta IV booster on its transport after being offloaded from the ship, awaiting transfer to ULA's facilities at the Cape. At the docks, Falcon 9 booster B-1069 was laying on the transporter awaiting its trip to the SpaceX refurbishment facilities. This rather clean-looking booster recently completed its second flight with the Starlink 4-23 launch. This booster's first flight was back in December when it had a hard landing, resulting in the engine bells being damaged by the octograbber, which explains the longer-than-normal turnaround between flights. We were also treated to excellent pictures of SpaceX support ship Doug with the fairing halves from the Starlink 4-20 mission. Recovering and reusing these fairing halves saves SpaceX millions of dollars on each launch. And finally for this week, our flyover was fortunate enough to catch some recovery training of the manned space capsules. First, SpaceX's Dragon capsule was seen in the waters of Port Canaveral. Crews regularly perform Dragon recovery training operations to stay sharp. NASA recently announced that they have extended their commercial crew contract with SpaceX by 5 more crew missions out to Crew 14, which should get them to the current expected end of service for the space station in 2030. Boeing's Starliner capsule, which is not yet crew-rated, but rather preparing for its first manned test flight, was spotted being pulled towards the dock and the awaiting crane. This training seems to be just for emergency recovery, as Starliner is designed to touch down on land rather than on water. As we wrap up this episode, I'd like to give a special thanks to all of our tiered members both on YouTube and Patreon. It's people like you that keep us rolling. Thanks again for tuning in to our latest SpaceX and Starbase weekly update with a splash of Astra in Blue Origin. We'll see you next week, and thanks for watching. LabPadre out.